Before the break, you heard former Treasury Secretary Larry Summers say why he thought the Council of Economic Advisers' analysis of its own tax plan is dishonest. Well, joining me now from the White House lawn is the man responsible for that analysis, Kevin Hassert. Mr. Hassert is chair of the White House Council of Economic Advisers. Thank you so much for joining
us. It's great to be here, Fareed. Thanks for having me.
So the heart of Larry Summers' contention is that the plan is dishonest because it claims that what amounts to about a $1,300 tax cut, that is per worker, per household, somehow gets magically translated into $4,000 or even more than that by the alchemy of your analysis. What is wrong with his critique, and why are you right?
Sure. Well, first of all, the tone of the critique is extremely, incorrect. And, the fact is, if you think that we did something wrong, then you should accuse us of making an error. But accusing us of being dishonest, it's just beyond the pale. It's not really becoming of a former Treasury Secretary. But let's get past the ad hominem attacks and go to the substance. You know, what Larry Summers did is he's like on his fifth attack now, and each one has been exposed as a horrendous Econ 101 blunder. The first is this point that you raised, and the fact is that right now we have a corporate tax of the U.S. that has an enormous amount of deadweight loss because we have the highest corporate tax on earth. It doesn't raise much revenue at all because the people are transfer pricing their profits over to Ireland. It's something you've talked about a lot over the years. And so right now we get almost no revenue because they create a job in Ireland, move the revenue there, increase the demand for labor there, drive wages up there instead of here. And so this idea that you can compare the change in revenue to the change in wages has been exposed as a really critical blunder, Economics 101 blunder, by Greg Mankiw at his blog at Harvard, by John Cochran at Hoover, by Casey Mulligan at the University of Chicago, by Larry Kotlikoff and his co-author at MIT. I mean, these are people at top universities that have exposed the fallacy of Summers' very, very simple mistake.
But
and I'm kind of stunned
think,
that already a week later you're still you talking about it here. I mean, come on, it's been exposed as a mistake and you're still asking about it. I don't understand why. Let's go back to the substance of the proposal, please.
But none of them believe that the wage gains would be anything close to what you
That's just
are
false.
Estimating.
Why did you say that? I mean, Larry Kotlikoff, he said that it's $3,600. And we put out a study today that estimated the wage impact from a whole host of peer-reviewed studies. You can go back to, I think it's page 24 of the study, and you'll see that there's a whole bunch of things that are way north than $4,000. But let's think about why that's not a crazy number. Let's get away from the ad hominem attacks for a minute. So if you look at it, real wage growth has been almost nothing over the last 8 years. In fact, it was only 0.6% a year over the last 8 years, while profit growth was about 11%. That's something you agree with, right? Well, if you look at where wages come from either higher human capital formation or higher physical capital formation, and capital deepening in the U.S. over a five-year average period dropped into a negative territory during the last 4 years of the Obama administration for the first time in U.S. history. And so we're not getting wage growth because we don't have capital deepening. We don't have capital deepening because we're chasing the capital overseas. This is Econ 101.
So let's talk about the effect on the deficit. If you look at what happened after the Reagan tax cuts, the national debt tripled. If you look at what happened after the Bush tax cuts, massive ballooning of the deficit. Why isn't it the case that these tax cuts will follow the same path and explode the deficit?
So let's think about the things that we agree about, Fareed, for a minute. So you agree, right, that the U.S. has the highest statutory corporate tax rate in the developed world, correct?
But most companies don't pay that at that rate as
right.
an effective
and so they
rate.
Don't pay it. So why is it that they don't pay it? They don't pay it because they've moved the profits overseas. There was a National Bureau of Economic Research study that came out in the spring that estimated that more than half the U.S. trade deficit comes from the transfer pricing by U.S. multinationals of their profits overseas.
But why
so we
won't
have
it
this high tax
the
rate that they don't pay? We have this high tax rate that they don't pay, so why does lowering the rate to encourage them to return the activity back to the U.S. Why does that cause the hole in the deficit? I mean, it doesn't. It's just illogical, Fareed.
Would you stake your reputation, Kevin, on the notion that this tax cut will not increase the deficit substantially?
I have to wait and see the complete plan before I give a deficit estimate. But the corporate tax side is, there's barely any corporate revenue right now, and we've got the highest rate on earth. And there's a big literature that shows that that's because people move the money offshore. And so if we cut the corporate rate here, what will happen will be that capital deepening will go back to about the historic average of about 0.8% per year. that'll drive up wages by an additional 0.8% a year or so. And then if you do the math for Reid, starting at with incomes of about $83,000 for the average family, that 0.8% per year gets to this number relatively quickly. And once you see that, once you do the math for Reid, then you're going to see how ridiculous it is what these guys who used to be economists are saying about this plan and about the CEA's activity. I mean, it's obvious. It's very, very simple math. There are lots of studies that confirm it. And the people that are trying to, I just poison the discourse by casting aspersions and so on, are just trying to get your attention. And I think that you're playing into the coarsening of discourse by giving them the attention rather than focusing on the facts.
Kevin Hassert, pleasure to have you on, sir.
It's great to be here. I hope I can come back. Thanks for me.